Hey everyone, Jexy here. Welcome back to another video. So I'm super excited. Earlier this week, or end of last week, I guess, I posted on Twitter asking anybody if they had any questions that they would like to ask me in regards to my experience with addiction and recovery, and to use the hashtag AskJexy, and then I would address their questions in a video. So in the future, if you have a question you want to ask me, please hop on Twitter, use the hashtag AskJexy, and I will absolutely answer your question. Today, we are going to answer a question from Andrea, and she asks if sobriety is too black and white when it asks for complete abstinence. So, I don't know, I think it's a great topic, so let's chat about it. Okay, so on Twitter, Andrea, at 25 years, one lesson, asked me, what do you say to people who think sobriety is too black and white by asking for complete abstinence? I think that's a great question because it's brought up a lot in discussions about recovery as to whether you can be clean if you're using any type of substance, whether recovery has to be complete abstinence. So there's definitely a few ways to look at it. For myself, I use a complete abstinence model of recovery. I know for myself that it would be really dangerous for me to think that I can use any substance. I know that I don't have like that switch in my brain that says like you've had enough. Like I even have to be careful with things like cold medicine that I take like the exact amount prescribed because it's so easy for me to think like, oh, a little more, I'll be okay. And I can do that with anything. So for me, complete abstinence is a safety thing. It's a great way to safeguard my recovery and to make sure that I don't ever get myself into a trap that I can't get myself out of. I did have a relapse the first time I had been clean for about 4 months, and I had thought it was a good idea to have a few sips of alcohol. A few sips of alcohol turned into a few more, and this was like at a fancy restaurant. And by the time I was on my way home from the restaurant, I had convinced myself that it was a really good idea to use pills. And I wouldn't have gotten to that point had I not drank, but that put me back into a couple months of a hot mess. I picked up right where I left off, and I was miserable, and then I had to go back into detox. It was a mess, and it all started from a few sips of alcohol. So for myself, I know that alcohol is dangerous. However, I know that my way, and the other reason that I stick with complete abstinence is because I am a member of a 12-step program, and 12-step programs define being clean or, you know, being sober as complete abstinence. So because that's the program that I like to use for my recovery, it's the place I feel like I fit in the most. I know that I can't be a part of a program like that if I say like smoke pot on the weekends. I don't necessarily believe that if I smoke pot on the weekends, I'm going to go back to using pills. I never really associated pot as being a drug. It was more like how like cigarettes are, right? However, it is a mood or mind altering substance. And I know for me, if I smoke pot, I can't go into this 12-step program meetings and say that I'm clean, and I need to be able to identify with those people to stay in recovery. So for me, complete abstinence is beneficial for multiple reasons. So that's always going to be what I recommend to people because that's my experience and I've seen that work. But I also know that complete abstinence isn't the only way. And I, for one, never judge anybody for the program that they use. There are a lot of studies, and I'm speaking kind of like off my ass here. I don't have anything linked, but if you're interested, reach out to me and I will find them for you. But I have seen studies done regarding the benefits of what they call the harm reduction model, which is what a lot of people are using when they talk about not using their drug of choice, but using other substance. For example, if somebody was a super hardcore heroin addict and they get off of heroin and they start smoking pot to deal with the withdrawal and then they kind of stick with that, that would be considered using the harm reduction model. Smoking pot is safer than doing heroin, therefore you're moving in the right direction. So there's a lot of studies out there that say that that type of model is beneficial to people. And I think what's important too is recognizing that addiction is a deadly disease, right? Like Addiction kills people regularly. Overdose deaths, like statistics, are unreal the last couple years. I don't know specifically what number leading cause of death they are in the US, but I know it's been steadily rising. And it's horrifying to think that people are dying from something that should be preventable, right? Like nobody should be dying of overdoses. We have all these tools out there to protect people and to get people the help they need. So to find out people are dying from this disease is awful. So if a harm reduction model is going to keep people from dying, then I'd say that it's a benefit. So if smoking pot is going to keep you from sticking a needle in your arm and overdosing on fentanyl-laced heroin, then I'm not going to judge you for smoking pot. If you go to a doctor and he says, "Well, look, you need, ADD meds or anxiety meds or whatever medications," I'm not going to judge you on that. I'm also never judge people who are on medications like Suboxone or Vivitrol or methadone treatments. Regardless of what my personal feelings are and what's going to work for me, I don't think it's fair for me to judge anybody else on their program. I can offer suggestions based on my own experience. I can say that, look, I know that if I have a few sips of alcohol, that leads me to a bad place, right? I have that experience. That has happened to me. So I can share that experience with others so that they don't have to go through that same trial and error period, right? I would hate to see somebody think that they could drink, go from drinking to their drug of choice in one night, and then look back and be like, man, I wish I knew I couldn't drink, right? So I share my experience with things like that because it's always about safety. It's about progression. It's about being able to do better. I know for myself that if you would have told me that a harm reduction model saying, well, maybe I could smoke pot, I could have become just as obsessive with using a substance like that because I was trying to fill a void. If I'm not doing any work on myself and working on recovery, because recovery is so much more than not using drugs. Recovery is really about digging deep into ourselves and trying to find a new way of life, a way to live as better people. And that's so much more than putting down the drugs. We can put down the drugs, right? But that doesn't mean our life is going to change in any positive way if we're not doing any work on ourselves. We can still be shady, lying, stealing type people, even if we put down the drugs, if we're not trying to better ourselves, become better people. So I think that I would have used the, if somebody would have told me that I could smoke pot and be fine, I would have done that. I'd be smoking pot every morning, every night, and whatever. And it would become obsessive because I was thinking it was okay. And I think that for addicts, that's something we do have to be careful for. Are we substituting one drug for another? Are we using something in place of our drug of choice to keep us feeling that feeling of being high? Look, maybe I like the way that pills make me feel more than pot does. I don't know, but one drug can, I can kind of settle for that feeling. I need to make sure that that's not my reasoning. So if you're using a harm reduction model and you know you're making steps forward, then I'm never going to judge you. If I see that you're using another type of substance as a crutch and it's not so much a harm reduction model, but it's an excuse to use, I may just share my experience with you and what's worked for me. I don't ever tell people what they should or shouldn't do. That's not my place. I can't tell somebody what's going to work for their recovery or what's going to benefit them in their recovery. I'm not a doctor. I'm not a psychologist or psychiatrist. I'm none of those things. All I am is a person who has some experience in recovery. I've had a relapse well in my past. I have a little over six, I have about 6.5 years now. And so I can share with you what works for me and what doesn't work for me, and what I've seen other people go through, what I've witnessed, what I've helped friends through, right? But I don't judge people on their programs. So yeah, I do think that we need to be a little bit more open-minded about what recovery means to people and what that entails. I think the important factor is not judging others. I know a lot of people on YouTube who do very different things for their recovery. I don't judge any of them, and their experience can be helpful to other people. My personal way of doing things is the complete abstinence model. I participate in 12-step programs. That's what works for me, but I'm just one person. And so I don't know. I think we do need to be kind of open-minded, and we need to, on both sides. If you don't believe in complete abstinence, but you've never sat down and heard both sides, maybe it would be beneficial to do so, because maybe learning about how people are living without using any substance, something you can benefit from, right? The important part is not judging people, not making people feel left out, and not making people feel unwanted, right? We need to support each other. That's the hardest part about being an online creator, is that we want to give a message of support, right? No matter what, I am going to support your process. I am going to be supportive of anybody's process. I do things my way because they work for me, but I don't need to push that on other people. So I would love to hear your thoughts on this topic. Leave me comments. Tell me, is your recovery program based on complete abstinence? Have you seen people use other types of models? Is there a certain drug that maybe you don't consider a drug? You know, let's chat about this. The only way that we can learn more about what other people think is by having open dialogue. Let's not be afraid to talk about things. So if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. It's always helpful. If you're not subscribed, I would love you to do so. Then you'll know when another video comes out. I post new videos every Tuesday and Friday. I hope you guys all have an awesome week, and I'll see you again on Friday. Have a great day, everyone.